UNB alumni and football fans of all ages. Welcome to UNB Homecoming 2019 and the playing of the 9th annual Tony Proudfoot Memorial Game. As has been the tradition since 1949, every UNB Fredericton football team makes their way onto their home field to the same familiar fight song, which became known on this campus as Bombers Away. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2019 UNB Fredericton Red Bombers.
Listen to them.
You please rise and remove your hats for our national anthem, played today by UNB honors student Tony Kelly. Tony is one of our Red Bombers alumni. Thank you, Tony. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to center field the new president of UNB, Dr. Paul Mazzarol, accompanied by the Red Bomber alumni who are with us today. We'd also like to draw your attention as they come out to the banners on the clubhouse at the west end of the field, and in particular to the banner on the left honoring Tony Proudfoot, whose number 24 was retired from UNB football by the Red Bombers in 2011. Tony Proudfoot was co-captain of the Red Bombers in 1969 and 1970. He was an All-Canadian in 1970, along with his co-captain, Dick Flynn. Tony went on to enjoy a long and successful career in the CFL, playing 9 seasons with the Montreal Alouettes and 3 seasons with the BC Lions. Tony played on 5 Grey Cup championship teams, winning the Grey Cup in 1974 and 1977. Beyond his career as a professional football player, Tony spent 30 years teaching physical education at Dawson College in Montreal. He also lectured at Concordia and McGill University. The Red Bombers were honored that Tony made the trip back to his university roots here at UNB in September 2009 to witness the rebirth of the UNB Red Bombers football team in the inaugural game of the Atlantic Football League. Some of the Red Bomber alumni who played in that game are here with us today. Sadly, we lost Tony the next year to ALS. Each year at our homecoming game, we celebrate Tony's life and ask that you give generously to the fight against ALS. Tony left an indelible memory here at UNB and everywhere he went. As a result of a public nomination contest in his hometown, Pointe Claire, Quebec, residents will be opening a new park in 2020 to be named the Tony Proudfoot Park. In our own effort to remember Tony, we take the opportunity at this game each year to present the Tony Proudfoot Scholarship created by the Proudfoot family. please welcome at midfield Tony's brother and a former Red Bomber himself, Chuck Proudfoot, and Tony's niece, Madison, a UNB alumni, along with the head coach of the Red Bombers, Vince Sturgeon. The Tony Proudfoot Scholarship is presented each year to a Red Bomber who is a full-time student in the Faculty of Kinesiology. We would now ask Chuck and Madison to make the presentation of this year's Tony Proudfoot Scholarship to Red Bombers running back Cameron Casey. Cam is a third-year kinesiology student with an outstanding record of academic achievement. Cam is currently mending on the injured reserve list with the Red Bombers and is a member of the Bombers Players Executive. Congratulations, Cam. Thank you, Chuck, Madison, and the entire Proudfoot family. We're pleased today to also have at midfield some of the players from the 2009 to 2018 Red Bombers era. This year marks not only the 70th anniversary of the Red Bombers team, but also the 10th anniversary of the founding of the Atlantic Football League. In 2009, after a 30-year hiatus, we saw the return of the Red Bombers to this campus as part of the Atlantic Football League. As the championship banners on the clubhouse in the end zone attest, these Red Bombers would go on to be a force to be reckoned with in the years to come. In 2009, the inaugural game of the AFL was played on this field and between these same two teams. The game was won by the UNB St. John Seawolves on the strength of a field goal in the dying minutes of the game. The win also rekindled the Battle of New Brunswick rivalry and added to the competitive spirit between the two campuses. Both the Red Bombers 2012 and 2017 AFL Championship games were played on this field, both to packed houses. Both championships were won on the last play of the game, and both on the strength of incredible Red Bombers defensive stands. As one of the alumni said after the 27 championship win, I was over at the bench taking oxygen at the end. I didn't breathe for the last 2 minutes. These players on the field in front of you represent the most recent Red Bomber players who revived Red Bombers football spirit on campus and across the city. They honored the Red Bombers past, but added their own chapters to the UNB Red Bombers legacy for the future, and in so doing ensured that football was once again an important part of the athletic community at UNB Fredericton. Welcome home, Red Bombers. As you may have seen in the Toronto Star this week, we are also celebrating another Red Bomber alumnus, Tom Pinkert, a long snapper with the 1966 Red Bombers team, punted an unbelievable 114-yard kick in the September 24th game against St. Dunstan's University. Known today as UPI at College Field, Tom's punt from the 21-yard line went through the end zone and was stopped only by the fence at the back of the field. This record kick surpasses any university or professional punting records in North America. Ladies and gentlemen, the Red Bombers football team club's board of directors, on behalf of the players, coaches, alumni, and fans, this year decided to establish a new Unsung Hero Award. This award is to be granted periodically to individuals who serve the best interests of our team and who often do so quietly and behind the scenes without recognition or acknowledgement. Today we wish to honor four such individuals who were instrumental in ensuring that the dream to reestablish Canadian football on this campus came true in September 2009. Making the presentations to these four individuals today are Michelle Richardson, the current chair of the board of directors, and Mike Dolomer, our head coach from 2009 to 2013. Handing off the retired helmets are our four current team captains, Luke Saunders, Dylan Waugh, Gabrielle St. Germain, and Turner Sturgeon. Our first recipient is Mr. Cyril Lutz Wallace of Ottawa, whose vision for a new team and whose ability to secure major financial support from the Ottawa alumni was a critical factor in the return of our football team. Unfortunately, Cyril is out of the country today, but accepting on his behalf is Mike DeMello. Cyril, for your contribution, the board of directors wishes to thank you by bestowing upon you the first ever Unsung Hero Award. Our next recipient is Mr. Bob Skillen, UNB's Vice President of Advancement, formerly Development, played a very important role in paving the way with the university administration, as well as securing the necessary seed money that allowed us to take the field in 2009. Bob, for your contribution, the board of directors wishes to thank you by bestowing upon you the first ever Unsung Heroes Award. The next recipient, Dr. Larry Wisniewski, was involved in bringing back our team from the very start and was involved in every facet of the process, from negotiating with the university to establishing the league. As our first general manager, Larry was responsible for absolutely everything related to the on and off field operations, from being on the board of directors to setting up the field for game day. Larry, for your contribution, the board of directors wishes to thank you by bestowing upon you the first ever Unsung Heroes Award. Our final recipient today is Mr. Brian Freeman. Brian was the chairperson of the board for many years and was instrumental in developing a good working relationship with the university and building a new relationship with the university and the community. His expert leadership has allowed the Bombers to become the strong and well-run organization it is today. Throughout the past 10 years, no job has been too big or too small for Brian. His dedication to our program has been remarkable. Brian, for your contribution, the board of directors wishes to thank you for your contribution by bestowing upon you the first ever Unsung Hero Award. Ladies and gentlemen, without the extremely generous contributions of these four terrific people, UNB Fredericton would simply not have a football team today. From all of us, thank you. And now, here is today's starting lineup for your Red Bombers. At offensive line, number 52, Mark Doucette. At offensive line number 64, Luke Saunders. At offensive line number 55, Sebastian Surrett. At offensive line number 67, Cameron Butler. At offensive line number 68, Kyle Tower. At receiver number 80, Brady Manderville. At receiver number 84, Sam Phillips. At receiver number 88, Matt LaFleur. At receiver number 12, Jake McKay. At receiver number 87, Jackson Green. At quarterback today, number 6, Will Hicks. And the running back, number 21, Dylan Waugh. And now, Dr. Mazurill, if you are ready, please do us the honor of the homecoming game ceremonial kickoff.
Don't know. I can hear in my headphones, it's real loud. So.
It's really loud?
Well, yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Mazurill, and welcome back to UNB. Mr. Head Referee, the field is yours, sir. Let's play some football.
Can you hear yourself?
No. Yeah, no, not, well, a little now, yeah. We all got, tell me when we're... Check. I can hardly hear myself. Check.
Okay, you're one.
I think it's one. Okay. Yeah. You all set?
Okay.
We all set, guys? Can you hear me? Check 2-3. Check 2-3. Red Bombers, here we go. Here we go. Check, check. 1-2-3. Check, check. 1-2-3. Check, check. Check, check. 3. Check, check. 1-2-3. Check, check. 1-2-3. Check, check. 1-2-3. Check, check. 1-2-3. I can hear that here. We all right? Do you want me to try another one?
Try that one.
Check, check. 1-2-3. Check, check. Check, check. Tell me when to start.
Go ahead.
Good afternoon, all you Red Bomber and Seawolf fans everywhere. Today, we have the UNB SJ Seawolves taking on the undefeated UNB Red Bombers for the Tony Proudfoot Memorial Homecoming Game. It's going to be a great football day at BMO Field. It's a little bit overcast, a balmy 18 degrees. And we have a great homecoming crowd here to see if the Red Bombers can remain perfect for 2019. Of course, we had presentations earlier with the Tony Proudfoot Scholarship. Mr. Cameron Casey was the recipient of that. And also the brand new president of UNB, Dr. Paul Mazerol, did a ceremonial kickoff. And as Dr. Eddie Campbell used to say, it was a perfect day for UNB president, as they were always undefeated, given that it's UNBSJ versus UNB Fredericton. So we're all set to get started. It's going to be a great day. And we're just about to get started. We've got the referees moving either way. So remember that the Seawolves are 0-2. Had a really tough game against against Holland College last week, where they were defeated on the very last play of the game. And then also played Dalhousie hard in a what I think we understand was a really windy day. But today, wind shouldn't be much of a factor. Sun in the eyes of the receivers won't be much of a factor. And we're all set to get started. It's going to be Connor Pelkey doing the kicking duties for UNB St. John, and away we go. And Jake McKay takes the ball back for the Red Bombers, and we're going to be first and 10 on the UNB, let's say, 24-yard line.
He brings the ball out just short of the 25-yard line. It'll be first down, Red Bombers.
William Hicks is the quarterback starting for UNB, and we're going to see if it's the return of the first two games in the Dylan Waugh show. Dylan Waugh gets the ball to the left-hand side of center and is brought down short of a first down.
Dylan Waugh with the carry.
Looks like he's got about 6 yards.
6 yards. It'll be second and 4 for the Red Bombers.
Second down and 4. Dylan Waugh once again. Right hand side. He goes by 3 tacklers from UNBSJ, and it looks like a first down
Dylan
for the Red Bombers.
He gets outside and fights for the necessary yardage. It'll be a first down, Red Bombers.
UNB running behind those 7 excellent offensive linemen. It looks like we've got a few more receivers out here. Different set for UNB. Had motion, play action, pass to the right-hand side, incomplete. Intended for Matt LaFleur. So Coach Spurgeon putting some different looks. The first two games, it looked like it was 7 tight offensive linemen for most of the time, but they tried to move things around with some early motion and then a quick pass into the flats for Matt LaFleur, but it was incomplete. It's now second down and 10. Motion again. Long ball. For Matt LaFleur, it's complete. He's going all the way. Touchdown, Red Bombers. Jake McKay was the receiver on that play. 6 points for the Red Bombers. Well, we can see a different look for the Red Bombers versus the Seawolves already. And that Dylan Wiles on the ball twice. They tried one incomplete pass, and then there was that nice post pattern down the middle to Jake McKay. Here's the replay. As you can see, Jake took it in. He had a small stumble, but he'd already been by the three St. John players. Easy touchdown for Jake for a good start in the first quarter for the Red Bombers. Now it's their attempt for the extra point. Matt Mills with the easy chip shot. So at 13-14 of the first quarter, it's 7 for the UNB Red Bombers and no score for UNB St. John Seawolves. So some of the early stuff that you may have seen, another broadcast that we had at the beginning of the game was to talk about a pretty significant event in Red Bomber history, was the longest punt in the history of any football in North America, which was Thomas Pinkard 53 years ago, September 24th on 1966. Originally, he'd been given credit for an 89-yard punt, but the forensic staff went back to the drawing board, and it turned out it was 114 yards. So this outdoes the NFL, outdoes the CFL, and any other football that would have been North America. And we think that Tom might be listening. So Tom, good on you. Please grab a beverage of your favorite point as you join us today. And if you get back here for another Red Bombers game, the beer's on me. So here we go. We got Matt Mills to start off for a return and give the Seawolves a chance to answer that early touchdown by the Red Bombers. Seb Brown is waiting for the ball along with Jordan Betteridge. Long kick by Mills. And the Seawolves get to about their own 43-yard line.
Matt Mills kick fielded by number 27, Akeah-Hook.
Akeah-Hook took the ball for the Seawolves, so it's going to be first down and 10 for the Seawolves. Of course, the Red Bombers have Gabe St-Germain on the defensive line. And we're all set now. And it's complete for a first down, Seawolves. That was Jared Lemming, who was the quarterback, who threw to Seb Brown.
Seb Brown, that's a first down for the Seawolves. Tackled by the Red Bombers by Marcus Urquhart.
It's going to be first down and 10 from now into Red Bomber territory on about the 53, 52. Three wideouts to the right. Pass again to the left-hand side. Once again to Seb Brown. Does a move to the inside. He's gone down the sidelines. And he's taken out of bounds. Looks like about the 15-yard line of the Red Bombers. Big return, big play by Seb Brown.
Again, this time for a big gain, brought down by Trenton Bannister. It'll be a first down, Seawolves deep in the Red Bombers territory.
Trenton Bannister was the tackler for the Red Bombers. So very quickly, the Seawolves answer that first touchdown by the Red Bombers and are threatening on the Red Bomber 15. Lemming again at quarterback. He puts three receivers and a running back out to his right-hand side. High snap. Looks left again. And Seb Brown brings it in for a touchdown, Seawolves.
Lemming's pass complete. Again, to number four, Seb Brown, and that is a Seawolves touchdown.
Well, looks like, just like last week, it's a quick opening of two touchdowns. Defense is not necessarily showing up as the offense go away. And here we go, the replay for the touchdown. As you can see, there's a bit of a high snap. It Lemmy's going to do a quick little look to the right, but once again, he looks at Seb Brown to the left-hand side, throws a nice high ball. Red Bomber defender was in position, but Seb Brown makes a circus-like catch for the touchdown. Back to live action, and Lemmy again for the conversion, and it's all tied up. 7-7. We've got 11:32 left in the first quarter.
Right back. We've got a tie score.
So quick answer by the Seawolves, who have bit a little bit snake bit on their first two games, but boy, they're looking like they've got at least one strong hook up here on offense. So a big touchdown to come back right away and tie up this game against the Red Bombers. And while we're waiting for the kickoff, there were some other presentations as we started. The Unsung Hero Awards were given out to Cyril Lutz Wallace, Bob Skillen, Larry Wiz Wisniewski, and Brian Freeman for all the work that they did to get the second generation bombers. And here we go again. Jake McKay, once again, he's gone by a couple of tacklers and he's brought down. Looks like about the 37, 38 yard line on their own side of half.
Too close to the 40 yard line.
So this will be interesting as to see what the offensive coordinators for the Bombers come up with. They had started with the first two plays with what we've seen for the first two games with the seven offensive linemen. But it looks like we're back to what we saw for the last two plays, and we've got lots of receivers and running backs out there. Will Hicks again to Dylan Waugh, up the middle, huge hole. Big gain for Dylan Waugh, past the 50-yard line of the Seawolves for a first down and 10.
Dylan Waugh with the big gain for the Red Bombers. He's into Seawolves territory. It'll be a first down, Red Bombers.
So Red Bombers spreading out the Seawolves defense, but it's just what we've seen in the first two games. Dylan Waugh up the middle, Dylan Waugh left, and Dylan Waugh right. We've got first down and 10. Dylan Waugh once again up the middle, another big hole. He's cutting through, another big first down for Dylan. I don't see any flags. Should be first down and 10 once again for the Red Bombers on the Seawolves 31.
To the Seawolves 30-yard line, it'll be another first down for the Red Bombers.
Hicks again at quarterback. He's got Dylan Waugh lined up to his right-hand side. Dylan Waugh once again to the left, wide open on the outside. He's brought down by number 27, okay, a hook for the Seawolves, and it's going to be second down.
He's got a gain of 7 before being brought down by a hook.
Looks like the Red Bombers have 3 yards to go to gain another first down. Hicks is coming back from instructions from the bench. Again, you can see the defense of the Seawolves. Whatever the Red Bombers have been doing, they've been spreading everybody out, so you've got a lot more room down the middle for Dylan Waugh. Oh, fake handoff, and Hicks is brought down by number 2, Godfrey Agbavi from the Seawolves, and it's third down.
He's brought down in the backfield by Godfrey Dabawadi.
Godfred Agbavi, the big defensive play for the Seawolves. It's going to be third down.
Third and 9 for the Red Bombers.
Looks like on third down, the Bombers are going to be scrimmaging. Three wideouts, 4 wideouts, split to the right. Hicks steps back, looks downfield. Oh, almost intercepted, but that will be failure to gain a first down, and possession will go to the Seawolves, first and 10 from the line of scrimmage.
By Anthony McIntyre for the Seawolves.
Oh, there's a flag on the play.
There's a flag on the play.
Oh, Looks like it was rough play by the Seawolves, but that's a dead ball foul, so it'll be applied after the possession goes back to the Seawolves. So it looks like it'll be first down and 10 from the Seawolves' 15-yard line.
15 yards where the Seawolves will scrimmage first and 10.
Of course, in the background, you might hear the dulcet tones of Jeff Landine, who's the on-field announcer for the Red Bombers, which is why everybody should be coming down to BMO Field to see this game live, because there's nothing like it. Okay, here we go. Seawolves are set to go. Jared Laming behind center once again. He's got wideouts to his left. And typical for the Seawolves, they're bringing in one of their slot backs in tight for blocking. Laming looks to his right. Wide open, number 12. Looks like a first down, and he's out of bounds.
Seawolves pass complete to number 12.
So that was number 12 for the Seawolves.
That'll be a first down.
Seawolves asking questions of the UNB defensive backs early. In all these passes, they seem to have been wide open. And there's a toss out to the left-hand side, a quick fumble, and defense. Your Red Bomber defense is all over that play.
It's to Caleb Morgan, but he's mad.
Caleb Morgan was the ball carrier, but he didn't get much of a chance. The toss was a little bit behind him, and then the Red Bomber defense was all over him. So it's going to be second down with a loss. Looks like about a 3-4 yard loss, so it'll be second down and 13 for the Seawolves to try and get a first down. Same set for the Seawolves, most of the receivers off to the left-hand side. Here comes their slot back for some extra blocking. Looks right once more. Big catch by number 12 for a first down, Seawolves.
Laming's pass caught by number 12 for the Seawolves.
Well, some impressive catches by the Seawolves on both of those series. Lamming's putting that ball in there, but they're either high or behind. It really doesn't matter. These receivers are able to bring him in with nice soft hands, and the Seawolves get the benefit of another first down. Looking left, pass downfield off of a couple of hands. It's incomplete.
Lamming's pass intended for number 17, Keegan Duffley.
Keegan Duffley was the intended receiver. Kyle McGraw, the defender for the Red Bombers, that had a chance to bring that in, but it's a little bit too much of a surprise. Now we have second down and 10. We've got more and more people of a homecoming crowd that are coming to BMO Field, so we've got a great crowd. We've got cheerleaders. We've got everything going on. If you can make it, please come join us for the second, third, and fourth quarters of the game. Quick pass to the right-hand side. It's behind Seb Brown. It's going to be third down for the Seawolves.
For Seb Brown, that's incomplete. It'll bring up third and long for the Seawolves.
So I think the quarterback for the Seawolves, Laming, is also their punter. So this will give some options to the Seawolves as to whether they're necessarily going to punt or they're going to pass or run. Snap over the head of Laming. He's having a trouble finding the handle. He's able to get the punt off, but not very far. Referees blow it dead. I think there's a rule with regards to something that doesn't cross the line of scrimmage to make it a dead ball. And it'll be first down and 10 for the Red Bombers.
But it gets whistled down inside Seawolf territory. It'll be a first down for the Red Bombers.
So from an impressive start on the aerial war of the Seawolves, it's a little disappointing on their side. They weren't able to make any yardage after that first down, and now it's going to be first down and 10 from the Seawolves 45 for the Red Bombers. We still have Will Hicks at quarterback for the Red Bombers with 5:51 left in the first quarter. Same set as we've seen at the beginning of the game with three wideouts to the right-hand side. Dillanois up the middle. He's held up quickly by number 28, Josh LeBlanc from the Seawolves.
Dillanois with the carry.
Short gain.
He's met immediately by Josh LeBlanc for the Seawolves. Struggles forward for a couple yards. It'll be second and eight for the Red Bombers.
We'll see what Coach Spurgeon has sent into his quarterback Hicks, what they have up their sleeve for second down and eight. Hicks steps back, looks to his right, post pattern down the middle. Oh! Thomas Hoyt was wide open, had the ball go right through his hands. It is incomplete for a third down and eight.
That's incomplete. It'll be third down and eight.
You'll see Will Hicks, he's going to step back here. He's looking right down the middle on that post pattern, and Thomas Hoyt is wide open. Nice, easy ball. He's all set to bring that in. I think he had visions of touchdowns in his head before he was able to bring that in, and it's incomplete.
Houses that are in attendance today. Welcome, Harrison.
So we've got third down, Red Bombers. They've made a shift of their personnel. Let's see if they're going to punt or they're going to try for the field goal.
Lady Beaverbrook and Neville Jones.
St. John taking the time to figure out where that ball's coming from. Big, quick tackle. Brady Manderville with the tackle for the Red Bombers. Brought that returner for St. John. That's Colin Slay, who brought that back. So it's going to be first down and 10 on the their own 20, just over the 25-yard line. 4:48 left in the first quarter. We had a lot of fireworks on the first couple of series, but it's calmed down considerably now. Defense is adjusting to what the offensive brought up. Jared Laming setting up. Let's see what St. John has up their sleeve for this play. Hand up off the middle. Bombers are able to bring him down after about 5 or 6 yards. That was Caleb Morgan as the ball carrier for the Seawolves.
Caleb Morgan with the ball, with the carry for the Seawolves. It'll be second and five.
Looks like it was a 5-yard gain. Three receivers split out to the right-hand side. Big rush by the Red Bombers. Brought down behind the line by number 98, Winston Legere.
Laming caught in the backfield by.
Here's a replay on the play. You can see Laming, he's going to take the snap. He's going to look to his right-hand side, but here comes Legere around the right-hand side and an easy sack for him. Referee blows that down early to make sure no one gets injured, and it's going to probably be a punt by the Seawolves to the Red Bombers. Matt LaFleur is going to be waiting for the punt for the Red Bombers. And, of course, Laming is the punter for the Seawolves. Snaps much better this time to Laming. He's able to get it high in the air. Lots of room for LaFleur. Chooses to go to his right-hand side. Moves by two of the Seawolves. Still moving and brought down deep into, well, mid-deep into Seawolves territory.
Punt fielded by Matt LaFleur.
On about the
39-yard
line of the Seawolves.
It'll be a first down, Red Bombers.
So Red Bombers are in scoring territory. We'll see if they're going to be able to put up, break this tie with the Seawolves. A little bit more of a chess game as we've seen between these two games than we've seen from the first couple of Red Bomber games. Same set that we've had. We've got Watt to the left of Hicks. Fakes the handoff, and it's touchdown, Red Bombers! Do not see any flags on the play. Jake McKay with the touchdown for the Red Bombers.
Hicks
Did a nice little corner pattern from the middle of the field, and that was a pretty quick answer by the Red Bombers. Here comes a replay. You can see the fake handoff. Hicks throws it to his left-hand side, and again, wide open in the middle of the zone is McKay. Two defenders go down, not able to bring him down, and McKay does the easy stroll into the end zone for the touchdown. Matt Mills going to set up for the extra point. Once again, easy chip for Matt Mills, and he's made it now 14 in favor of the UNB Red Bombers, 7 for the University of New Brunswick St. John Seawolves. So there's 2:57 left in the first quarter. If you're just joining us, the game started very early with a pass by the Red Bombers to go up 7-0. The Seawolves turned right around, and Seb Brown got a circus catch to tie the game at 7-7. But now the Bombers have brought it back to make it 14-7. Who got the first touchdown? McKay. So Jake McKay has both touchdowns. Matt Mills setting up for the kickoff to give the ball back to the Seawolves. He kicks to his right-hand side. Fumbled a little bit forward by the Seawolves receiver, Jordan Betteridge. He's able to make a gap and brought down on his own 50-yard line.
Jordan Betteridge
by Brady Manderville.
He brings the ball all the way out to the Seawolves' 50-yard line. It'll be a first down for the Seawolves.
Here's a replay on the kickoff, as you can see. There's a little bit of a fumble, but then is able to bring it in nice and easy. Comes back up the middle. Nice little wall and a great hole. He's quick to go through that hole. Again, special teams in question by the Red Bombers. In the first two games, the opposition have done a great job of bringing it back, and we're seeing the same thing again here. Must have been an illegal substitution, or there's an equipment problem with number 56, so they're putting somebody in on the defense. Head referee whistles time in, and we're away to go. Laming looking to his right-hand side. Long ball. Defender in the zone. It's incomplete. Number 12 was the intended
receiver.
Was the intended receiver, but was able to be defended by the safety by UNB. Don't know if you were able to see on the camera, but the UNB defender was there waiting for him. Early on, he backed up expecting that ball was going to be there. So a great play by that UNB defender. Second down and 10. Equal split of the receivers. Laming again down the middle. Through his hands. Intercepted by the Red Bombers. Number 9, Trenton Bannister, brought that in for the Red Bombers. We will change possession. And it is first down for the Red Bombers.
Trenton Bannister. Red Bombers ball
on their 47. As you can see, the play where Bannister was able to bring it in went through the hands of the St. John receiver. Keegan Duffley was the one who was intended for. So Seawolves offense has to be frustrated. They've had some receivers that were open, but the UNB defense, or the Red Bomber defense, is starting to come up heavy. And here we go, first down and 10. Hicks again at quarterback. Fakes it to Wad, does a flare pass out to his left-hand side. Goes by three Seawolves for a first down. That was Matt LaFleur. Nice play by LaFleur.
LaFleur brought down by Josh LeBlanc, but that is a Red Bombers first down.
So a little bit more flair by the UNB offense than we've seen from the first two games where it was just the Dylan Waugh show, but now we've had all kinds of passing, a lot of fake handoffs. So they're taking advantage of St. John keying on Dylan Waugh and then finding the open gaps along the field. Dylan Waugh once more up the middle, ran into a little bit of a traffic jam with his own players in motion. It'll be second down. Coach Spurgeon looking on his offensive menu. Let's see what he comes up with. We've dispensed with a lot of the bread and butter. We've had a little bit of the sizzle from the steak. We'll see what happens on second down and nine. Fake to Waugh, pass to the left-hand side. Quick look in pass. He's wide open down the middle. He could. Yes, it's a touchdown, UNB. Sam Phillips was the receiver in a quick licking pattern to the left-hand side and was successful going through the Seawolves defense for another touchdown by the Red Bombers. Here comes the replay, and we see it just after the catch, and you can see him weaving through those defenders. St. John desperately trying to, and he's able to do a nice easy stroll Sam one more time for another 6 points by the Red Bombers.
Sam takes it all the way to the end zone.
So with 19 seconds left in the first quarter, Matt Mills is going to set up for the extra point. Once again,
and with the point after,
like a song you want to hear over and over again, that point is good. It's 21 for the Red Bombers versus the UNB St. John Seawolves. So Coach Spurgeon with the Red Bombers going through the air much more than what he's been doing in the first two games, but he's setting it up with play action. He's trying to look at those running plays, and the Seawolves have to respect those plays, leaving the receivers wide open. And the Seawolves have to be disappointed that a lot of these passes end up being 7 or 10 yards, and defensive backs are unable to bring down the UNB players. So they're taking advantage of this. Here comes Matt Mills to get this game started once again and kick off to the Seawolves. And they're trying for a short kick to the left-hand side, but it did not carry 10 yards, so that's why you're seeing all the penalty flags fly. It'll be an option to the Seawolves as to what they'd like to do, whether they're going to take scrimmage where the ball was dead or whether they're going to ask the Red Bombers to kick again.
Red Bombers kick did not travel the required 10 yards.
As you can see, the call was a legal procedure, and the selection by the Seawolves was to scrimmage the ball on the Red Bomber 51-yard line, first down and 10. 19 seconds left in the first quarter. Laming looking to his left-hand side. Oh, big defensive play on number 56 in the Red Bombers. And I can't find a name.
Laming's pass defended by number 56, Adam Lamy.
Adam Lamy was the defender who was able to knock that down for the Red Bombers, so it'll be second down and 10.
That is the end of the first quarter.
So first quarter's done.
We're going to take this opportunity to tell you about a few contests we have going on.
So our officials are going to be very happy that they don't have to travel a great amount of distance in order to set this up for the second quarter, and we're going to have another beginning here.
Visa gift card if your number is drawn in the third quarter.
So again, don't forget that we've got a good homecoming crowd here, and of course they're celebrating 10 years or more of the rejuvenated Red Bombers football or 70 years of football by UNB Red Bombers. And it's a perfect day for the football players. A little overcast still, 18 degrees. Not much of a wind to speak of if you're looking at the indicators on the goalposts. And again, this excellent broadcast is brought to you by our friends at Streamlight Productions. So second down and 10 for the Seawolves. Equal split by the receivers left and right. We had motion by number 52, Griffin Seeley of the Seawolves. We'll see if that was induced by the defense. Looks like that was procedure Seawolves. That'll be a 5-yard penalty and second down again, 15 yards to go.
So that is against the Seawolves. It'll push the ball back 5 yards. It'll be second and 15.
Seb Brown set up to the right-hand side of Laming. We've got a timeout called by the Seawolves.
Timeout Seawolves.
So once again, if you met some of the, saw the early presentations, this is the Tony Proudfoot Memorial Game. Tony was an all-Canadian player at UNB who eventually went on to the Montreal Alouettes and the BC Lions. He was a winner of two Grey Cups while he played for the Alouettes and the Lions. And of course, he's also famous for the staple game where the Alouettes were able to defeat the Edmonton Eskimos in a Grey Cup at the Big O when the field was covered with ice and Tony was able to find a staple gun and put it into the cleats and make sure that there was an advantage for the Owls. We had Tony's brother, Chuck, hand out the award today to Cameron Casey, who was winning the scholarship. So here we go. We're all set to get started with the second quarter. Second down, 15. Laming looks down the middle, throws to his right. Seb Brown again. Big catch by Seb Brown. Steps in and then out of bounds.
Pass complete to number 4, Seb Brown. And the Seawolves have a first down at the Red Bombers 20-yard line.
Seawolves showing off the air attack. Here's the replay. Again, you can see Laming. Quick little look down the middle, but quickly looks for his most trusty receiver, Seb Brown. Nice release. UNB defender was tight to him. Looks like he was able to make a play, Josh Armstrong, but just over his hands, and Seb's able to bring that in before he quickly steps out of bounds. We have first and 10 from the UNB 19-yard line. A little bit of play action. Doesn't look like that was exactly what they had on the playbook. And Winston Legere is able to sack Laming.
He is brought down by Red Bombers Winston Legere and Adam Cogswell.
Looks like about a 6-yard loss.
Just a loss. It'll be second and 16, Seawolves.
And as you can hear, Jeff Landine has no problem with new math and is able to add the 6-yard loss to the 10 yards previous, and we've now got second down and 16. It's amazing what happens when you get a PhD. Well, UNB defense certainly has to be focused on number 4 as he's been the favorite receiver of Laming so far in this game. Looks to his left-hand side. Laming was having a tough time as he was being pressured by number 30 of UNB, Alec Ferris, and not able to set for that pass. It's incomplete. And third down and 16 for a first down. Red Bombers doing a good job of pressuring Laming on some of these plays, not giving him a chance to set. Every chance he's had time, he's been throwing some beautiful balls to his receivers, but when he's rushed, of course, it makes it that much harder. So once again, Laming being the quarterback as well as the punter, not defense, not really sure as to what's about to transpire here on third down and 16. Laming decides to punt. Ball bounces in the end zone. It's now bouncing out. UNB picks it up. I would imagine there's no yards. Seawolves players not able to retreat quick enough as there is some backspin on that ball.
But there is a flag on the play.
Waiting for the referees to tell us where the ball will be placed for Red Bombers. Call is no yard Seawolves, but I think it's a 5 yard no yards penalty. So line judge is giving an indication to the folks with the down box to set this up. It looks like it's just ahead of the looks like it's UNB 12-yard line. They're going to scrimmage first down and 10. Ball's given to Dylan Waugh up the middle. He's brought down fairly quickly for what looks like about a 3 or a 4 yard gain.
Dylan Waugh with the carry for the Red Bombers.
So no surprise with the Red Bombers deep into their own zone that they're going to give it back to the very dependable Dylan Waugh. Got about a 3 yard gain, so it looks like about 2nd and 7. We've got a small injury timeout. Luke Saunders having a little bit of difficulty, so we've got a trainer out. Coach Spurgeon giving some instructions to Jonah Rollins. So we've got a replacement at quarterback for UNB with Jonah Rollins behind center, replacing Will Hicks. And typical to what we've seen in the earlier two games, Coach Spurgeon making sure that it's almost equal time with his two pivots here. We're about to get time back in. Steps back, throws to his right, and it's incomplete.
Jonah Rollins in a quarterback.
Intended for Matt LaFleur.
His pass intended for Matt LaFleur falls incomplete. It'll be 2nd down Red Bombers, 3rd down Red Bombers.
There was a penalty procedure against the Red Bombers. That was declined by the Seawolves, and it's now 3rd down.
Against the Red Bombers, declined by the Seawolves. So it will be 3rd and 7 for the Red Bombers.
Pretty easy decision for the Red Bombers being so deep into their defensive zone to punt and try and get a little bit of more insurance of territory for the Seawolves. We've got number 25, Colin Slay, as well as number 34, Jordan Betteridge, that are going to be waiting for the punt from the Red Bombers. Good punt from the Red Bombers over to their right-hand side. Slay has got the ball, is able to make a small gain, but brought down relatively quickly. Brought down by
Colin Slay.
Mr. Betteridge, I think.
Brings him down after a short gain. It'll be 1st down Seawolves just inside the Red Bombers territory.
So the Seawolves are in Red Bombers territory. They're scrimmaging from, looks like, the 46 of the Red Bombers. We've got one of the Seawolves player in a little bit of a difficulty here. So again, as a quick review, we've got 11 minutes and 43 seconds left in the second and quarter. And if this is one of the first games you picked up from the Atlantic Football League, UNB Red Bombers are 2 wins, no losses. Seawolves have lost 2 close games, so they're 0-2. And of course, the Holland College Hurricanes are 1-1, and Dalhousie Tigers are 1-1, and they'll be meeting a little later today, as I believe it's in Holland College. Seawolves player looks none worse for wear, and we're about to get started with first down. 3 wide out split to the right-hand side of Laming. Pressure by UNB up the middle, and he's brought down with a sack. Gabriel Saint-Germain, an all-star from 2018, is successful for the Stockwell, the Red Bomber defense. Big loss by the Seawolves offense. That's basically a 10-yard loss to be second down and about 20 from the Red Bomber 54-yard line. Or I'm sorry, from the Seawolves 54-yard line. So 20 yards to gain by the Seawolves. That gives the Red Bomber defense a little bit more room to back up and be able to take some time to see what Laming is about to bring out on offense. Quick little pass over the middle. Incomplete. Middle linebacker Spurgeon was able to knock that ball down. It'll be third down and 20.
That'll bring up third and long for the Seawolves.
Seawolves sending a lot of the receivers deep and trying to find a soft underbelly of the Red Bomber defense, but Spurgeon was all over that, seeing the screen set up.
Go to East Side after the game for half-price appetizers from 8 p.m. to close tonight.
10 minutes, 39 seconds in the second quarter. Good pressure on the outside, not very deep on the punt by the Seawolves. Nice high bounce. Oh, he's got some room coming on the left-hand side. Tucking that ball in, he's scooting around that right. And that's Matt LaFleur with a big return by the Red Bombers.
Matt LaFleur with the return for the Red Bombers.
He's able to get into Seawolves territory, and it's going to be first down and 10. From the 51.5-yard line of the Seawolves. So Red Bombers making the best of that territorial interchange back and forth. But I see a flag on the play. I think that's going to be brought back. We're holding on the return.
There was a flag on the play, and it would be holding against the Red Bombers. That's going to take the ball back.
So here we see the replay with LaFleur going the outside, but we don't have a chance to see where that holding penalty was. So unfortunate turn of events for the Red Bombers with a nice big return, but they do have the ball back, first down and 10 with 10 minutes and 5 seconds left in the second quarter. Quick toss up the middle. He's rolling to his left-hand side. Big block on the outside to get him on the outside, but we've got a flag.
Rollins toss to Matt LaFleur.
Matt LaFleur had a nice sweep on a quick toss from Rollins. But the official threw a flag on the play. Not sure whether they would call that a clip or a hold. They're calling holding on the play.
And the call is holding against the Red Bombers.
It looks like they assessed the penalty from... They assessed the penalty from where the infraction was.
It'll be first down repeated. First down Red Bombers now at their 31.
So they probably assessed the penalty after LaFleur had gained a first down, and then they called the holding. So it was after he had gained a first down. So they have first down repeated with basically what was the line of scrimmage. So two successive penalties bringing the Red Bombers to miss on some of their offensive gains. Ooh, we had some interesting play and a big break free on the left-hand side by Dylan Waugh. First down, Red Bombers, no flags on the play.
Dylan Waugh with the carry. There's no flags on the field, so that will be a Red Bombers first down.
So typically you would see Dylan Waugh with a bread and butter play either up the middle or right or left, but you're now seeing Coach Spurgeon bring out a lot of sizzle with a lot of movement into the offensive backfield before Dylan Waugh gets the ball, but it's able to open up some even bigger holes for him for an impressive first down. Big pass down the middle to number 12.
Rollins
Jake McKay, the receiver on that play, and another first down for the Red Bombers.
And Jake carries it down to the Seawolves 41. It'll be first down, Red Bombers.
And Dylan Waugh gets the ball up the middle again. Engaged very quickly by Tyler Ring-Dineen, but successful for a great gain.
Hard to bring down, gets pretty close to a first down.
Looks like a 9-yard gain, setting up a second and one.
Red Bombers.
Well, given what Coach Spurgeon's been doing, there opens up all kinds of options as to what he'd like to do with second and one. Is he going to try and do a little bit of trickery, or is this going to be the Dylan Waugh show once again? And he keeps it up the middle. Rollins following the monstrous offensive line of UNB, and why not depend on those guys to give you another 2-3 yards? And it sets up another first down. So we've got three first downs on this drive.
In addition to getting your picture taken,
Red Bombers showing some better discipline than they had earlier with the flags on the return as well as the flag on the first down and 10. Dylan Waugh set up to the left-hand side of Rollins. Early motion. Quick flare pass out to the left-hand side. And it's complete. Brought out of bounds for Matt LaFleur.
And he's brought out of bounds just short of the first down marker.
Looks like he got about 7 yards. It'll be second down and three. Rollins bringing out all kinds of options with the Red Bomber offense. Again, equal split of receivers both to the left and the right-hand side. Waugh set up to the left-hand side of Rollins. Easy hand up the middle. Dylan Waugh finds a nice hole and is able to get another first down deep into Seawolves territory, setting up a first down and what looks like goal.
That's going to be a Red Bombers first down at the Seawolves 9-yard line.
Not a lot of deliberations by the Red Bombers here, and they're setting up again for the first down and goal. Dylan Waugh to the right-hand side, and he's scooting for the corner. Not able to make it. Big tackle by number 34, Jordan Betteridge, by the Seawolves.
He tries to get the corner, but Jordan Betteridge stays with him.
Looks like a small loss on the play by the Red Bombers. It's still second down and goal.
Second down and goal for the Red Bombers.
Well, for the first two games, we haven't seen Dylan Waugh lose a lot of yardage, so that's going to be a bit of a surprise to him and also the offense, but they're going to take another crack at it with second down. Rollins looking to his left, passes in the end zone, waiting for the indication from the officials. That's a touchdown, but we have a flag on the field. Looks like offside, Red Bombers is the early indication. Head referee confirms that it's offside, so that'll be a 5-yard penalty, second down once again. Here's our replay. As you can see, Rollins is going to step back. That might have been on the far side with...
That'll take the ball back.
Nice ball, and as you can see, just steps over, keeps his feet in there, but that flag is down for the offside, which negates that nice play by the Red Bombers. So about 13 yards away, the Red Bombers are going to try once again to see if they can punch this in for a touchdown. Stalwart defense by the Seawolves on this series. Roland steps back, looking down the middle, post pattern. It's a touchdown, Red Bombers! Brady Manderville with the touchdown for the Red Bombers.
Pass complete to number 80, Brady Manderville.
Here we're going to get to see the play. As you see, Roland steps back. Nice post pattern coming into the middle. As you can see, Manderville coming just behind the defenders. A nice catch. Easy touchdown for the Red Bombers. And now Matt Mills once again setting up for the extra point. Oh, a little bit of a fumble. And it's knocked down. So Red Bombers unsuccessful with that conversion, but that now puts it at 27 for the Red Bombers, 7 for the UNB St. John Seawolves, with 4:55 left in the second quarter.
Bannister's best efforts. So that leaves the score 27 for the Red Bombers, 7 for the Seawolves, with just under 5 minutes left in the half.
Red Bomber coaches have to be happy with a little bit better discipline by their charges as that started to get a little out of hand with a bunch of penalties, but they were able to recover. So we've got two touchdowns by Jake McKay, one touchdown by Sam Phillips, and now the latest touchdown by Brady Manderville, giving a good lead to the Red Bombers before 5 minutes left into the second quarter. Matt Mills setting up for the kickoff, and maybe not. I think I see a different player setting up. Might be Marcus Urquhart. So let's see if UNB's got some trickery up their sleeve to get things started with this kickoff. Seawolves having a bit of problem with the math, having too many people waiting for that kick, but they've got that corrected now. Little bit of a chip shot to the right-hand side. Easily taken by the Seawolves. That's Akia Hook with the reception. So the Seawolves are going to be scrimmaging from their own 38-yard line. First down and 10.
Red Bombers. Seawolves will have a first down at their own 38-yard line. Stick around at the half. The Lady Glads are going to be hosting our game punt, pass, and kick competition.
Same looking offense for the Seawolves as they come out for first down and 10. Urquhart backing up a little deeper, and it looks like it's going to be an easy run up the middle for the Seawolves. That's number 30, Caleb Morgan, is the ball carrier, short gain. Sets up for second down and about 8 yards to go.
That punt, pass, and kick competition at the halftime is participatory, not something to be observed. Get ready to come out on the field and show your skills.
Seb Brown lining up on the left-hand side. Oh, flag on the play. Pass in the middle for number 12. He's got an easy gain for a first down. He goes by a couple of Red Bomber players. Taken out of bounds deep into Red Bomber territory, but we have a flag on the play.
The Seawolves number 12, taken out of bounds by Ian Saunders. There is a flag on the play.
The penalty was offside Red Bombers, but that was declined by the Seawolves, so that's a big gain.
And that flag is against the Red Bombers, so the Seawolves decline it. And they will take the big first down and the ball at the Red Bombers' 34-yard line.
So Seawolves scrimmaging from the Red Bomber 34-yard line. See if they can put up a few more points before they take that break for halftime. Great catch and run by number 12 and the Seawolves on that play. Looks like a little bit of confusion on the part of the Seawolves, and they've called a timeout.
Timeout, Seawolves.
So once again, we've got a great homecoming crowd here to watch the Seawolves take on the Red Bombers. Pretty impressive offensive beginning, but a couple of errors by the Seawolves have allowed the Red Bombers to put up a fair lead now with 27-7. Their favor, but always looking dangerous, this Seawolf offense is, seeing if they can tighten this thing up before they make the halftime break. Mr. Spielberg, if we can have a little look at the cheerleaders while we're waiting. Okay, we're just about to get started. Laming looking to his left-hand side. We've got the big interception by the Red Bombers.
Laming's pass intercepted by number 9, Trenton Bannister.
Trenton Bannister was standing there waiting for that ball from Laming as a free safety. Easy play for him. Just wanted to make sure that he didn't drop it, so he's able to shut down that drive by the Seawolves. Got to be frustrating for the offensive coordinator for the Seawolves, as it looked like they had some good momentum for the end of the second quarter. So we'll see which part of the playbook Coach Spurgeon's going to bring this up. Is it going to be running behind his mammoth offensive line, or is he going to make open things up a little bit more in more of an aerial attack for Rollins? Time's whistled in by the head referee. We've got 3:09 left in the second quarter before halftime. Head referee blows up the play. Not sure what the problem is. So head referee doing a little bit of a hully-gully, explaining what is going on in the play, but it doesn't look like there's any harm or any foul, and we're going to start again with first down. Fakes to walk, quick throw out to the right-hand side, but dropped by number 38, Nick Duffy. Not necessarily a bad play, as there were three Seawolves waiting for him to catch that ball. We've got second down. Oh, that's a 3-minute warning by the head referee for the end of the second quarter.
Warning. 3 minutes left in the half.
Second down and 10 for Red Bombers. Waugh set up to the right-hand side of the quarterback. Looks down the middle, and he's wide open. Rumbling down the middle, does another look. Nice block to the outside. He's past number 14. He could go all the way. Touchdown, Red Bombers. Sam Phillips with another touchdown for the Red Bombers. Big play. As I look on the field, I do not see any flags. That is going to count. Here comes our replay. As you can see, Rollins steps back. We've got some intermediate patterns in the middle, but a nice post pattern coming from the left-hand side. Two Seawolves not able to make that play, and Sam Phillips is able to romp his way all the way into the end zone. Nice, easy block there by Jake McKay. Or I'm sorry. And there he goes into the corner of the end zone. Big play. Now setting up for the conversion by Matt Mills, and it is good.
So that 90-yard pass.
So back to live play. We have a score of 33 Red Bombers, 7 Seawolves.
Red Bombers, 34, Seawolves, 7.
So Sam Phillips getting his second touchdown. So isn't this interesting? We're now just about at halftime, and we've got two touchdowns by Jake McKay, two touchdowns by Sam Phillips, one touchdown by Manderville, and Dylan Waugh, the regular go-to player that has been carrying the Red Bombers for the first two games, has basically been an observer in the offensive backfield, setting up all of the rest of the charges to having an impressive first half for the Red Bombers. So significant questions being asked of the Seawolves defense. Let's see if they're going to be able to regroup. Marcus Urquhart again to try the kickoff for the Red Bombers. Sends it deeper down the field. Jake Miller, oh, it's a fumble, recovered by the Red Bombers. Big play, and Brady Manderville was able to get that ball back for the Red Bombers.
By Jake Miller, and then stolen.
Here comes
by
the replay.
As
we can say, Urquhart with the kick to his right.
It'll be a first down, Red Bombers, at the Seawolves 15-yard line.
See what happened when Jake Miller went into contact. He's walking on the off the field. Protesting that he didn't think it was a bona fide fumble.
Lady Glad, remember the pass, punt, and kick, but the 50-50 total is at $300.
So you'll see Jake
right
Miller
now.
Take this. Blocking setting up just fine. Here's the early part of the play. Ah, there we go. And it's snatched away. Snatched away by Brady Manderville. That was an impressive play. So it's going to be the Red Bombers, first down and 10, deep into the Seawolves territory.
Andrew Martell is the winner of our Molson jacket. If Andrew is handy, if he could come up to the booth at the halftime, we'll give him his jacket.
Head referee has blown time in. We've got first down and 10 from, looks like, the 14-yard line of the Seawolves. Nice run over to the right-hand side. It looks like a touchdown for the Red Bombers. It is.
That is Garrett Doucette.
Garrett Doucette, the ball carrier for the Red Bombers.
And he finds the end zone for the Red Bombers.
And we're going to see this set up. Doucette set up to the left-hand side of Rollins. Lots of motion coming from the right-hand side. And look at that. We've got three big offensive linemen and a wideout doing the blocking. And Doucette does a nice, easy run to the right-hand side into the corner for another touchdown by the Red Bombers. Matt Mills setting up for the conversion. And if this is successful, there'll be 2 minutes and 5 seconds left in the second quarter. Once again, easy chip shot.
Matt Mills' point after is good. And there's 2 minutes left in the half.
So that's 41 for the Red Bombers and 7 for the UNB St. John Seawolves. So lots of Red Bombers contributing to this score so far for the Red Bombers. Everybody but Dylan Waugh putting in a touchdown. So a big change from the setup that have happened in the earlier two games. Seawolves thought they were going to get a chance to at least to put something up, but then again, there was an unfortunate interception by the free safety by the Red Bombers. Red Bombers got a touchdown, kicked off again, and we had Jake Miller, who looked like he was going to have a nice return, but then snatched out of his hands on a really quick play by Brady Manderville. And again, we can see the famous UNB Red Bomber cheerleaders on your screen. Marcus Urquhart to kick off again for the Red Bombers. And good return by the Seawolves. Looks like it was a Cuyahoga again. And it'll be first down and 10 for the Seawolves with 1 second less than 2 minutes left in the second quarter.
Brought down by Liam Cameron.
Flaming looking to his left-hand side. And it's over the head of Seb Brown on a comeback pattern. A little bit of argy-bargy on the sidelines with...
incomplete, it'll be second down, Seawolves.
To no account of anything, and it'll be second down and 10 for the Seawolves.
We're still looking for posts for that $100 Cellar Pub gift card.
Looking left again, and Seb Brown's wide open, and he's got a first down. Brought down by Spurgeon from the Red Bombers. It's going to be first down and 10 for the Seawolves.
He's brought down by Ian Saunders, but not before he picks up a first down for the Seawolves.
Seb Brown been a reliable receiver for Laming today, just having a tough time getting him at the important moments other than the touchdown he was able to get into the in the first quarter. So we're back in Red Bomber territory on the Red Bomber 51. High snap for Lamming. He's looking down the middle. Oh, he's tucked that in. He's going to run up the middle. All kinds of room. Slides in for a safe first down.
And he keeps and he slides close to the first down marker. Yep, that's a first down, Seawolves.
Well, it looks like the referee said he came down just a little early, and it's going to be second down, but gives lots of options for that Seawolves offense.
Second and one, Seawolves.
Time stop right now with 1:22 left in the second quarter. It'll be important for the Seawolves offensive coordinators to try and stop a little bit of this bleeding and make up some of the ground from what had happened in so far in this first quarter. And it's an easy quarterback sneak by Laming going for the first down, and they'll set up Laming for first down and 10 now.
And he gets the yardage. It'll be first down, Seawolves.
I would imagine the Red Bomber defense is going to be keying on Seb Brown. So we're going to be looking for it. Looking to his right-hand side. Ball's deep, intended for number 88, Justin Demons, but it's incomplete.
Justin Demons, that's incomplete. It'll be
second down and 10 for the Seawolves. Red Bomber defense with their normal setup. We've got running back set up to the left-hand side of Lemming. Looking to his left-hand side, looking deep for Seb Brown. He's wide open. Touchdown, Seawolves.
Pass complete to number four, Seb Brown.
Seb Brown once again, after a circuit catch from the first quarter, has another. So they've stopped a little bit of the bleeding. Here's the replay coming up. As you can see, Lemming's going to look down the middle and then look off to his left-hand side. You can see Seb Brown at the top of your screen. Not too much here. He's just going straight down the field. Had the Red Bomber defender look inside, and that was all she wrote. Easy walk-in for the touchdown. Wanting to make sure he's saving his energy for the second half. Seb Brown doesn't make any much of a celebration. And we're all set with Lemming to do the chip shot for the extra point. That's good as we can expect. So, Seawolves coming back a bit with 41 for the UNB Red Bombers and 14 for UNB SJ Seawolves with 42 seconds left. Boys, are we hooked up? We've got some guests to talk to here in the end, and also for the second half, we've got the illustrious Dr. Bob Forbes.
How do you do?
Hey, Bob. And for all you people that, you know, follow up the real celebrities of UNB football, we've got Rod Bell here with us as well. Hi, Rod.
It's a pleasure to be here.
So, of course, this is not only homecoming, but there's also a UNB Red Bomber football reunion celebrating the 70 years of football. And from and as we will all attest from the dark ages, not if you look at my hair, but from the dark ages of UNB football, when I was here, of course, Bob and Rod were playing for Coach Bourne and having fun on college field every day. So back for the reunion, and thanks so much for joining us, guys.
Pleasure. Nice to have Harry. At least you have hair.
Kickoff by the Seawolves. Taken easily by the Red Bombers and brought down right away. That was Jake McKay taking the ball for the Red Bombers, setting up first down and 10 with 39 seconds left.
It'll be first down Red Bombers at their own 19-yard line.
So, Bob, Rod, we've had a couple of guys coming back, like Steve Gale, and who are the other guys that have been back that you guys are spending time with on the field?
Steve gave me a call, and I responded in kind. He got a flight down from Montreal and picked him up, and they spent a few minutes at our house, and my son Patrick came along with us. And we got to hear yesterday, and you got to do the commentary.
So we've got the handoff up the middle for the Red Bombers. And I'm not sure if that was 35 for the Red Bombers as the ball carrier, since it's not Dylan Wye. I'm having a tough time.
Handoff to Liam Cameron.
Liam Cameron was the running back for the Red Bombers, and he's able to be successful with the first down. 37 seconds left in the second quarter. Coach Spurgeon pulling up all kinds of different things now for the offense. We've got Cameron on the right-hand side. Rollins again, ball up the middle. He's running to his left-hand side. Nice hole. Liam Cameron once again to the left-hand side. Looks like he's got about a five-yard gain.
5 yards, it'll be second and five Red Bombers.
So with 20 seconds left in the second quarter, we're going to see if Coach Spurgeon's going to bring something special or he's going to be satisfied with the lead he has now going into the halftime break. Once again, up the middle. No surprise here. Cameron looks like he's got the first down.
And it looks like he's got the necessary yards.
And one second left in the half, so we'll see if Coach Spurgeon is going to try and do anything fancy or they're just going to take a knee and go into the locker room with a good lead. Doesn't look like they're going to do anything special. Yeah, that's a kneel down, and that's the end of the half. So, again, at the end of the second quarter, we've got 41 for the UNB Red Bombers and 14 for the Seawolves.
But before that, we'd like to invite our UNB Fredericton cheerleaders to the field.
So that's been a great half for the Red Bombers. We're now moving in and setting up to have a chat with Rod and Rob. And Rob, you talked a bit about something important that I wanted to talk about, the fact that we've got at least two generations of Forbes playing UNB football, and you got your son Pat with you here for the reunion.
Yeah, well, he's come across more of his old buddies from football than I have here. There's quite a contingent of younger guys that have played between 09 and, well, current, and Patrick knows a bunch of them. And we got out last night and had some supper together, and I got to know some of his guys a little better than I knew them. better than I knew them before. And Steve and I came up and were hopeful that there'd be a number of guys from our era. And there have been reunions before where we were pleased with the turnout and had a good lot of the old guys. And it's a little sparse, though, this year.
Oh, well, I mean, they've been coming up pretty good. And Rod, you've been a regular attendee at these games. What's your impression from being with the Bombers in the 70s versus the addition that we're now seeing with the new Red Bombers?
It's amazing. It's great talent. It's the best $5 you can spend for entertainment on a Saturday here. Some great talent, and the kids are out there playing hard and having a blast. Well, I love being up here.
Well, guys, it's a treat to have you. And if certainly those people that were here in the 70s for us would know that you guys went from UNB to have a shot. I think where both of you went to Rough Riders camps, didn't you, after you came up?
I went to Rough Riders. And
that's Ottawa, right?
Yes, it was. Yeah, a good experience there. And didn't stay long. And I thought at the time that I might look at calling one of the other teams and seeing if I might stick with somebody else. Ottawa won the cup, so they didn't make any mistakes sending me home. but I might have gone on with somebody else if I'd had the nerve. And but I had a pretty good career coming otherwise, so I took the other option.
So fantastic.
Yeah.
So we really, thanks so much, guys, for supporting us coming out to this version of the Red Bombers. As we've talked about before, AFL's a big deal given that there's so much more high school football now from the time that maybe we were starting to go to UNB. Yeah. Throughout New Brunswick and Nova Scotia and Prince Edward Island, this is giving a great chance for guys to continue to play after they graduate high school, and some people getting a chance to go to the CIS teams like St. FX or Acadia or St. Mary's, and actually people were able to get some of those players back if they're going to do graduate programs and continue to play at UNB. So it's fantastic having you guys here. So thanks so much for joining us, guys.
Thanks so much for keeping football alive here in Fredericton.
All right.
Well done.
So thanks so much for Rob and Rod joining us. And we're going to take a break now for the halftime. And we'll join us for the third quarter for Red Bomber football.
I didn't have a chance to do my hair. You never told me it was going to be broadcast live.
I didn't know it was.
We're all a bit surprised.
I thought we were going to sit down. I can't make it down, I can't make it down. So get down, you can jump around.
I'm the cream of the crop. I rise to the top. I never eat the I'm a better yet, a Terminator. Like Arnold Schwarzenegger, trying to play me out like as if my name was Sega. But I ain't going out like no punk, bitch. Get used to one style, yo, and I might switch it up, bust around, then bust up, get down. Put out your head, man, you wake up in the dawn of the day. I'm coming to get ya, I'm coming to get ya. Spitting out lyrics, homie, I'll wet ya. I can't make it down, I can't make it down. So get out your feet and jump around. Jump around.
Welcome back for the second half. Just before we get started here, we like to keep up with the other UNB teams playing today.
UNB Fredericton baseball team.
So hello everybody and welcome back to the second half. Hope you've been able to find your favorite beverages in the kitchen and be able to get ready for an exciting second half of AFL football. Again, we've got UNB Red Bombers 41, UNB St. John Seawolves 14. Just about to get started again with the second half. And we want to thank Bob Forbes and Rod Bell for coming in to give us a little visit. And a shout out to everybody who's watching, whether we've got Phil Battaglia down in the States or Mike Arthur out in Nova Scotia. And hello again to Tom Pinkert, if you're watching. We've been celebrating your world record punt in the early parts of the celebrations today. So to give you a little bit of a recap, Red Bombers went up 7-0 with the first touchdown on their first series, but the Seawolves were able to come back and tie it up 7-7. Then the Red Bombers went on a bit of a run with some unanswered touchdowns through the first quarter and the second quarter. And in the last couple of plays of the second quarter, Seb Brown was successful with a touchdown to try and ease the bleeding a little bit for the Seawolves. But it's a bit of a daunting task for the Seawolves to come back right now. But we're about to get started for the beginning of the third quarter. Sun trying to break through in the clouds here at BMO Field. And a homecoming crowd getting excited for the third quarter about to start. Number 60, Connor Pelkey, is going to be the kicker for the Seawolves, and here we go. Big return up the middle for the Red Bombers. Jake McKay with the return, as he typically does.
Jake McKay, he brings the ball back to the Red Bombers' 30-yard line, where they will go 29-yard line. It'll be first and 10 Red Bombers.
So a quick recap. We've got two touchdowns by Jake McKay for the Red Bombers, two touchdowns by Sam Phillips, one touchdown by Brady Manderville, and the one touchdown by Garrett Doucette. And Seb Brown has both touchdowns for the Seawolves. So Red Bombers are going to scrimmage first down and 10 from their own 29 to get started here in the third quarter. Beer. Hand off to Doucette up the middle. He's still trucking. Yes, he's off to the left-hand side. Big openings. And he's brought down by number 34, Jordan Betteridge, but not until he's got a first down for the Red Bombers.
Garrett Doucette with the carry. Then Garrett picks up 20 yards.
We've got one of the offensive linemen down for the Red Bombers. That's never anything good. And we've got the replay. Here we go with Doucette coming up the middle. Goes right through one tackle, through another tackle. Seawolves having a tough time bringing him down, and he gets a little bit more yardage off to the left-hand side, claiming all kinds of ground until he's brought out right around the 50 or the 51 by Jordan Betteridge of the Seawolves.
As long as we're giving shout-outs, let's give a shout-out to the Stick Boys and the Water People who come to us from the Leo Hayes Lions. They would have been playing last night, but they're up.
So they're taking a little bit of time watching for the knee of number 52 for the Bombers. That's Mark Doucette. But looks like we're going to start to bring him back to the bench. Hopefully nothing too serious. Hobbling a little bit. But I'm sure the training staff of the Bombers are going to make sure that he's okay. So they're going to take a few more minutes to take Mark off the field, make sure that everything's safe before they get started. Play was whistled in, but of course they're not ready yet while they're still taking Mark Doucette off the field. So Will Hicks is back as quarterback for the Red Bombers, and it looks like we've got Garrett Doucette as his running back. And just to make sure that I am untruthful once more, we've got Jonah Rowlings coming out as the quarterback for the Red Bombers. Time whistled in by the head referee, so we're right on the 50-yard line. First and 10. Doucette, ball up the middle one more time. Doesn't get much of a gain. Ran into the backside of the UNB offensive lineman. Hopefully he didn't catch anything in the knees. Looks like he'll be fine. We've got second down and 10.
Doucette with the carry, brought down by Josh LeBlanc. No yards on the gain. It'll be second and 10 for the Red Bombers.
Rollins set back. Oh, we've got a screen pass for Doucette. Wide open onto the left-hand side. He's past that first down marker, and I don't see any flags. That should be first down for Doucette, for the Red Bombers into Seawolves territory.
14 yards. It's good for a Red Bombers. First down.
So Red Bombers taking advantage of the aggression of the front four and the linebackers of the Seawolves, opening up a screen pass to the left-hand side. And a nice gain by Doucette. So that's on the 46-yard line of the Seawolves, first down and 10. Hand off to Doucette up the middle, and he's making great gains. Looks like he should have another first down. Runs into a host of Seawolves before he's brought down.
Doucette with the carry. And Deuce picks up the yards for another Red Bombers first down. The 50-50 draw is up to $375 now.
Our friends at Streamlight Productions making sure that I'm not peaking before my time.
Visa gift card.
So we've got first down and 10 once more for the Red Bombers. Doucette once more with the carry up the middle. Nice hole. Looks like he'll have about 5 yards before he's brought down.
Doucette with the carry. He gets 4 yards, it'll be second and 6 for the Red Bombers.
So Coach Spurgeon going back to the bread and butter tray.
So all you students with a ticket that you got when you came in the gates, if you are holding ticket.
Looks like he's got about 5 yards before he can gain another first down.
0-4-2, that's 366-042. You have won a $500 Visa gift
card. So Jonah Rowland's waiting for the signal from Coach Spurgeon. He looked like he was a little further down on his playbook, so let's see if we've got something a little different than Doucette up the middle. Little play action rolling out to his right-hand side. Throws the ball, and it's complete.
Rollins pass complete
to Matt LaFleur.
score.
We're going to see a replay here. As you can see, the play action to Doucette. Make sure that he holds the linebackers and the rushers. A bit of a blitz from the Seahawks. Sea Dogs, Sea Wolves that drive him outside. Nice pass, great catch. Catching at the apex of the ball coming in by Matt LaFleur, and it's a first down and 10 for the Red Bombers. As you can see, nothing gets missed by Streamlight Productions in these games. We've got Doucette set up to the right-hand side of Rawlings, first down at 10. Ball's given to Doucette up the middle. He's gone past two tacklers. Looks like a short gain. Should be set up for second and something like about six.
Doucette with the carry. He gets five. It'll be second and five, Red Bombers.
Red Bombers are testing the Seawolves defensive line. It's going to be a long game if it keeps up like this. Doucette set up to the left-hand side of Rollins. Early motion. Looked like you were going to give the ball to LaFleur, but it's wide up and up the middle to Doucette.
Doucette falls for
Looks like he could be short.
We'll have to wait.
He had a nice big hole set up, but there was a defender that held up Doucette just for a second, so he was unsuccessful. So they've got a yard, maybe a little less than a yard, to go for the first down. Quarterback sneak, and we've got a flag on the play.
Rollins keeps. He looks like he has the yardage, but there are flags on the play.
Early indication from the line judge was offside against the Seawolves. And that is the call, offside against the Seawolves. Red Bombers will take that penalty for a first down, and
offside against the Seawolves. And
that'll be first down and goal.
Give the Red Bombers an automatic first down, first and goal.
So history would tell us that Coach Spurgeon's going to continue to test the interior lineman of the Seawolves, and let's see what play comes out. We've got Doucette lined up to the left-hand side of Rollins. Oh, play action. Rollins rolls out to his left-hand side and brought down just before he gets to the goal line.
Rollins keeps.
Head referee judges that he was down before he got to the goal line, so there will not be a fumble on the play. Second down and goal. Seawolves defense has to honor that handoff that has been so consistent from the Red Bombers, as well as the dominance of the offensive line. Here we go, second down. Quarterback sneak, Rollins going forward. Looks like an easy touchdown for the quarterback. It is touchdown, Red Bombers.
Jonah Rollins follows that big wall of red.
Here comes our replay. Not much mystery here. Just following that mammoth wall of the offensive line of the Red Bombers. Sticking with the singer that brought him there, and Rollins is able to get another touchdown for the Red Bombers. So it's now 47-14, looking for the extra point. And that was a good long drive by the Red Bombers. Seawolf defense is going to start to be tuckered if they're having a tough time stopping him in this bread and butter type play. Easy chip shot by Matt Mills. That makes it 48 for the Red Bombers, 14 for UNBSJ Seawolves.
This is the last
so at this point, you've got 8:51 left in the third quarter. This is going to be where it's make or break for the Seawolves if they're going to be able to return some of this stuff that the Red Bombers have been testing them with. Something a little unfamiliar for the first two games of the Red Bombers, where they had a tight contest, especially given the contest that they had against Dalhousie last week, where they were successful on the very last play with a two-point conversion. Taking Dalhousie Tigers 46-45. where they've got all kinds of rooms. So we'll see what happens with the personnel selections that the Red Bombers are making. Might give Coach Spurgeon a chance to put some other players a little bit down on the talent sheet to give them a little bit more experience in the AFL. And also being careful for injuries for the rest of the season. So a bit of a change here for special teams. Marcus Urquhart is not kicking, and Matt Mills is back doing the kickoff duties for the Red Bombers. Jordan Betteridge and Seb Brown waiting for the ball. Looks like Jordan Betteridge is able to take this. Nice wall set up by the Seawolves. And he's still working.
Jordan Betteridge with the return.
Number 85, Josh Armstrong was hanging on for dear life and finally able to bring down Betteridge.
Seawolves will scrimmage first and 10 from their own 40-yard line.
So from the 40-yard line, the Seawolves are going to scrimmage first and 10 and see if they can answer to the Red Bombers' long drive for a touchdown. Seb Brown is setting up to the left-hand side of Lamming. And it's a handoff up the middle. Good gain for number 30, Caleb Morgan. He's
Lamming
able to make close to 9 yards on that
when
play
Morgan
up the middle.
8 yards. It'll be second and 10 for the Seawolves. Oh, second and 2.
High snap again. Once more to Caleb Morgan.
Morgan with the carry again.
And easy breakthrough up the middle of the offensive line for a first down.
And 10 this time for the Seawolves.
Seth Brown setting up to the left-hand side. Equal split of the receivers. Right-hand side toss, and it's incomplete.
Lamming's pass, intended for Keegan Duffley, is incomplete. It'll be second and 10, Seawolves.
Ben Delaney was the, Keegan Duffley was the intended receiver, but the line judge had ruled that as incomplete. It's going to be second down and 10. Two Seawolves in the area that had a chance to catch that. So Lamming setting up once more with second and 10. Seb Brown running out to the right. You can, if you can see on the screen, Red Bombers are setting up a little bit of a double coverage on Seb Brown on the defensive backfield. Down the middle. And it's caught. Nice catch right up the middle by number 21, Braden McNamee.
21, Braden McNamee for a big game.
So if you can see the defensive backs of the Red Bombers, here comes the red replay. You're going to see Braden come from the left-hand side and then do a quick little post over the middle.
$500 Visa card.
Nice throw by Lamy. And easy catch over Spurgeon. And now it's first down for Lamy in Red Bomber territory. Caleb Morgan up the middle. And he was stopped after about 3 or 4 yards.
Morgan with the carry. He gets close to half the yardage for a first down. It'll be second down for the Seawolves.
Seawolves have a productive drive going here.
If you're holding ticket number 366065.
So it looks like they've got to go another 7 yards before they can get another first down.
You now are the
and
going
to be some questions for the Red Bomber defense to see if they can stop him here. Seb Brown lines up on the left-hand side, and as you can see, two of the defensive backs for the Red Bombers are reacting to that. Everyone is set up in man defense. Throw to the right-hand side. Ooh, nice try for that catch, but it's incomplete, going over the head of 17, Keegan Duffley. That sets up third down. And I would imagine with a 48-14 score, the Seawolves are going to try their best to see if they can get a first down or a touchdown on this series. Seb Brown setting up to the left-hand side of Lamming. Rest of the receiver core lined up on the right-hand side with Morgan in the middle as a running back. Snap looking to the left-hand side again for Seb Brown. Sure enough, he's got the catch, and he's brought down in the middle, but not before he's got a first down for the Seawolves.
Seb Brown, and Seb has a first down for the Seawolves.
Here comes the replay. Again, you'll see Lemmy looking down the middle, and then he's going to look to his left-hand side as he's got a quick look-in pattern by Seb Brown. Nice, easy catch for him. And takes three bombers to bring him down. So we've got first down and 10 from about the 12-yard line of the Red Bombers. A little bit of early motion by the Seawolves. Ball's handed off to Caleb Morgan. He goes past two Red Bombers before he's brought down before the 5-yard line.
Morgan with the carry. He's brought down by Winston Legere.
Looks like he's on the 8-yard line, so that would make it second down, and we're going to say 5.
Second and 5 for the Seawolves.
So for the two touchdowns that the Seawolves have, they've gone to Seb Brown. Obviously, there's going to be a lot of attention paid to Seb on the left-hand side. Snap about to Lamming. Steps back, looks down the middle to number 21, through his hands, incomplete. That's going to be third down and 5 to go. McNamee was the intended receiver, but the ball was a little bit behind him and he wasn't able to grab the handle.
That'll bring up third and 5 for the Seawolves.
Important play for the Seawolves here. Almost three defenders looking at Seb Brown on the left-hand side. Ball snapped high. Big snap rush. Ball's over the head of number 21, Braden McNamee. That's incomplete, and possession will reverse to the Red Bombers deep in their zone. So that'll be first down and 10 for the Red Bombers.
With 3 minutes left in the third.
And that'll be on their own 8-yard line. So with 3 minutes and 22 seconds left in the third quarter, the Seawolves are unsuccessful after a very nice drive, but not able to get any points.
And that winner is Sage Romsey.
So now we have William Hicks back at quarterback for the Red Bombers, deep in their zone. And if you're a betting man, you would think that the Bombers are going to continue to work that massive front line and stick with the running game to not only get some first downs, but take some time off the clock. No surprise here, the Red Bombers are up the middle. Nice carry by number 15, Liam Cameron.
Liam Cameron with the carry. Liam gets, it looks like, 8 yards. It'll be second and 2 for the Red Bombers.
Nice gain of 8 yards. Red Bombers set up again. Cameron to the right-hand side of Hicks. Ball again to Liam Cameron, looking for some space to the left-hand side. By the early indication by the line judge, that'll be a first down, Red Bombers.
Close to... No, we have a first down. First down, Red Bombers at their own 20.
So Coach Spurgeon has got some of his additional players in here, giving them some experience in the AFL. And if the Seawolves defense is unable to stop this, so I would imagine it's more of Liam Cameron up the middle. Liam goes to the left-hand side of the offensive line and makes about a 2-yard gain.
Liam Cameron with the carry, brought down by Chris Setchell for the Seawolves.
It's going to be second down and a little more than 8. And given the fact that they're deep in their zone, it'll be interesting as to Coach Spurgeon has quarterback Hicks call for the second down play. It's a pass. Hicks steps back, rolls out to his left-hand side, throws a dart to the left-hand side, but it's incomplete in front of number 88, Matt LaFleur. It's going to be third down.
That goes incomplete. It'll be third down for the Red Bombers.
So 1 minute, 8 seconds left in the third quarter. Other than the initial score by the Red Bombers, there hasn't been a lot happening here, but most importantly to the Red Bombers, time is ticking away, and there's a significant difference with this 48-14 score.
0-9-5-2-4-8-6-4. If you have that ticket, it's worth $407.
Flags on the play. Nice punt by the Red Bombers. Taken by Seb Brown. And Doucette able to make contact with Seb Brown. Officials are going to... The officials are going to call that the forward procedure of Seb Brown was called and the ball was dead just inside the about the 49-yard line of the Red Bombers.
At the Red Bombers' 50-yard line.
So there's an initial call is too many men on the field for the Red Bombers. Head referee giving the head coach of the Seawolves an option. Too many men on the field and the Red Bombers on that punt play, but it was declined given that the Seawolves have a good field position being in Red Bomber territory, so they're going to scrimmage first down and 10 from the 49-yard line. 45 seconds left in the third quarter. Seb Brown set up again to the left-hand side of Lamming. Hand off, and Morgan's... off hard to his right-hand side, but caught quickly by a Red Bomber defender. Again, that's Caleb Morgan. Looks like he might have had a gap there, but as he headed out to the right-hand side, he was able to be brought down by a defensive back
Morgan
by the Red Bombers.
Side, but he's wrapped up by Jack Houseman.
Jack Houseman was game a tackler for the Red Bombers. It's going to be second down.
We have a winner on the 50-50 draw. That winner is Lisa Wilson. Congratulations, Lisa.
Lamming looking downfield, passes down the middle, and it's incomplete. Intended Lamming for Braden McNamee, but it was over his head. Looks like it'll be third down.
It'll be third and 9 for the Seawolves. We've drawn a third number for that $500 gift card, so if you've got ticket number 366-036, come up.
And that's it for the third quarter. So again, not a big shift for the officials to move this ball the other way, so that we now have the Seawolves going from east to west. So 15 minutes for the Seawolves to see if they can eat into this significant lead of 48-14 that the Red Bombers have built up in the first three quarters of the game. Here we go. Time whistled in for the beginning of the fourth quarter by the head referee. Looks like they're set up for a punt. And they do let it go. Matt LaFleur letting it bounce. Looks like it would be no yards as the Seawolves are within the 5-yard circumference Lamming that they're supposed punt. To give on punt plays.
Caught by
Number 88, Matt LaFleur was there.
He's brought down by Griffin Seeley. There are flags on the play.
That's a 5-yard, no yards penalty that's called by the referees.
That'll move the ball up 5 yards. It'll be first down Red Bombers at their own 25.
So just past the 25-yard line, the Red Bombers are going to scrimmage first down and 10. We still have a good crowd here at BMO Field. Again, we have Liam Cameron lined up to the left-hand side of Hicks. He takes the ball up the middle. He's got a break up to the left-hand side. Nice gain by
Liam Cameron with the carry.
By Cameron.
He gets close to the first down marker. It'll be second and short, Red Bombers.
Looks like a yard and a half, maybe 2 yards that he has to go to get another first down. Red Bombers back to the bread and butter that brought him for the first two games. Cameron lined up to the right-hand side of Hicks this time. Easy handoff. Ooh, had a tough time trying to find the handle, which probably held him up from getting into second or third gear, and there's probably a short gain, if not a loss, on that play, which would make it third down for the Red Bombers. Red Bombers coaching staff not taking any chances and probably going to punt the ball away. So Seb Brown and Max Pastrick are going to be waiting for the Red Bomber punt and should have a chance to set up in Red Bomber territory. Ooh, a bit of a skip before the snap, but a nice punt gotten away. Big run to the left-hand side, good blocking, but nice tackle by number 80 of the Red Bombers.
Matt Pastorek on the return.
Brady Manderville with
Brady
the tackle,
down,
making sure that the Seawolves didn't get deeper into their territory where they were going to scrimmage from first down and 10 on the Red Bomber 39-yard line. Don't forget this broadcast is being brought to you by our friends at Streamlight Productions, doing a marvelous job, and hello to all the Red Bomber fans out there, as well as, I think, the Seawolf fans that were watching this production this afternoon. Nice day here at BMO Field, and we're all set to see if the Seawolves can eat into this lead that the Red Bombers have with 12:40 left in the fourth quarter. Lamming looking back, downfield to his right-hand side. Flag on the play. Looks like early indication would be pass interference.
Lamming
number 12.
Ben Delaney.
Ben Delaney was the intended receiver.
There's a flag on the play.
Number 85 was a defender by the Red Bombers. That would be Josh Armstrong. And given his name, that would be the problem. Josh's arm was a little too strong on that play, and he got a defensive pass interference penalty.
Pass interference called against the Red Bombers.
First down and 10 for the Seawolves. Knocking on the door. Seb Brown set up to the left-hand side. Let's see if he goes back to his favorite receiver on this play. Throws to his right-hand side. Oh, Red Bomber steps up. Armstrong with the interception, and he's got some room up the left-hand side. Nice return.
Lamming's pass.
Big play. Josh Armstrong redeeming himself from that earlier pass interference call. As you can see, Lamming setting up and looking to his right-hand side to take advantage of Armstrong once again. But doesn't quite put on everything that he had. And you can see Armstrong standing up in front of Ben Delaney and being able to get a really nice return on this play up the left-hand side. So once again, the Seawolves have to be frustrated. This is at least three times they've been knocking on the door of the Red Bombers and able to come away with no points whatsoever. We've got a new running back with Hicks at quarterback. And up the middle one more time. And it's a great run by number 28, Connor Stiles.
Connor Stiles with Gary. There's a flag on the play, but Connor has picked up 7 yards.
And the call is offside, UNB.
Call is offside against UNB.
That will be a 5-yard penalty.
So that'll go back and it'll be.
And that should set up first and 15 for the Red Bombers. That will probably ask William Hicks to use his arm a little bit here as they're going to have to gain 15 yards.
We have a new student ticket for that $500 gift card. I'll give it to you right after this play.
Connor Stiles lined up to the left-hand side of Hicks. And once again, he's taking the ball and a big tackle. Number 30, Caleb Morgan, was shooting the gap for the Seawolves and able to stop Connor Stiles after maybe only a yard gain. So Caleb Morgan doing a double duty of being the prime running back for the Seawolves as well as being a linebacker for the defense.
366.
So we've now got 14 yards and second down. Connor Stiles to the left-hand side one more time. Hicks steps back. He's being flushed out of the pocket, rolling to his right-hand side. Lots of room in front of him, and the ball is downfield, wide open. Wide open on the plays. Number 5, Thomas Hoyt for the Red Bombers. First down, I do not see any flags. Big play by the Red Bombers.
Thomas Hoyt.
And here's a replay on the play.
That's a first down with the Red Bombers.
As you can see, there's some good pressure by the Seawolves. They only sent 4 guys. They're still able to flush him out to the right-hand side. But it gave lots of time for William Hicks to look downfield, and he's able to find his receiver wide open behind the defensive backs. Easy catch just in front of the 40-yard line, and he's brought down. Here we go back to live play, back to Connor Stiles. Big run for about 3 yards.
Connor Stiles.
That was Jordan Betteridge who was able to make the tackle for on the earlier play on the pass play. That'll be second down and about 8 yards to go for the Red Bombers. 9 minutes, 49 seconds left in the fourth quarter. Looks like we got a player down by the Seawolves. Well, that's Caleb Morgan. No surprise there, he's been doing double duty. He has to be a little bit tired at this juncture of the game. Out comes Godfried Agbavi to fill in for him. So William Hicks checking on his wristband to see what Coach Spurgeon is called. And time is whistled in.
262? Yes. Fantastic. Okay, so your name is Emily.
Okay, we've got Connor Stiles to the left-hand side of William Hicks. We're all set.
U-R-Q-U-E.
Little flare pass. It's incomplete. Intended receiver was number 80.
Hicks' pass intended for Brady Manderville.
Brady Manderville.
That's incomplete. It'll be third and 8.
It's going to be third down.
We have a winner for that student gift card. Emily Bork is our winner of a $500 Visa gift card on this homecoming weekend.
So this is an interesting choice by the Red Bombers. It looks like they're going to try a field goal from about 32 yards away. And given Matt Mills had one of his attempts blocked last week, this is going to be I'm sure the coaching staff is going to pay a lot of attention to how the Red Bombers are able to execute on this play. I think we've got a small math problem for the Red Bombers. They've called a timeout.
Timeout, Red Bombers.
As it looks like they're shy a couple of bodies. One, two, Good check by Trenton Bannister to make sure that they weren't shy of the bodies that they needed on special teams. And here come the extra two. So here we go for the field goal attempt by the Red Bombers. Head referee doing a little bit of house cleaning to make sure that the offensive line understands what the guidelines are on who should be on what portion for this particular play. Kicks away. And it is wide left. Seawolves trying for the return. Looks like there's a lot of Bombers around him, and Sturgeon is able to bring him down inside the 10-yard line. So Red Bombers unsuccessful with that field goal attempt, but they have the Seawolves deep into their zone.
Brought out by Jordan Betteridge,
and
he's brought down by Turner Sturgeon.
Consistent with AFL rules, if the team's able to bring that out over the line, then the ball will scrimmage at the 20-yard line.
First and 10 from their own 20.
So as you can see, it's 9 minutes and 7 seconds left in the fourth quarter. Time being the biggest enemy of the Seawolves at this juncture of the game. So Lemming. Stepping back behind all the other Seawolves, and we've got Seb Brown lined up to the left-hand side. Big run up the middle, wide open for a huge gain by the Seawolves. That was number 17, Keegan Duffley.
Keegan Duffley with the carry.
Must have been a couple of mixed signals up the inner here. As you can see, the run on the replay, and he's able to break out to his right-hand side and all kinds of real estate to make up. Nice run by Keegan Duffley, and if I remember, and he finishes strong, being tackled by number 25, Ahmed Makhdoul. So we've got a Seawolf down on the play. Looks like it'd be one of their offensive linemen who... probably had a problem with a knee or an ankle on the play. So we want to mention again, there were some awards given out at the beginning of the game. First off, it was the Tony Proudfoot Memorial Game. So there was a scholarship given to Cameron Casey, who was the recipient of that, not to mention the fact that we had Unsung Hero Awards given to four people that were important for the building of the UNB Red Bombers, and that would be Cyril Lutz-Wallace, who unfortunately is traveling out of the country, but hello to Cyril, Bob Skillen, Larry Wisniewski, and Brian Freeman, who have done a lot to make sure that football is back. I think, as you know, this is our 11th season, so there's 10 years back of bringing Red Bomber football back to Fredericton, and this is the 70th anniversary of Canadian football at the University of New Brunswick. Still have that player down. Also to mention that since this is the Tony Proudfoot Memorial Game, a reminder that Tony was an All-Canadian player at UNB for two seasons, then went on to play for the Montreal Alouettes and then the BC Lions and was involved with two Grey Cup winning teams. So number 51, Sam LeBlanc was the player that was injured, but he's walking off his own steam, and that's great to see. Looks like they're going to be setting up pretty soon. And now we can see the banners down on the other side of BMO Field where we've got Tony Proudfoot and also Mike Dollimore, who was the first coach of the resurgent Red Bombers. So it looks like we're going to be back on the field. Time's whistled in by the head referee. Seb Brown lined up to the right-hand side, just in front of our broadcast booth. Lamming looking downfield to the left-hand side, wide open. Good catch by number three, Lucas Keating. Brought down by a couple of Red Bombers.
Complete to number three, Lucas Keating.
That looks like he's got about a 6 yard gain, so it'd be second down and four.
For the Seawolves.
Red Bombers switching some personnel, getting ready for what's coming from the Seawolves. 7 minutes, 42 seconds left in the game. Seb Brown lined up on the left hand side. Lamming stepping back. He's looking to his left. Deep ball for Seb Brown. And he brought it in again.
Lamming's long pass complete to Seb Brown.
Seb Brown turning into a magician today. He's been able to bring in three or four amazing catches from Lamming. You're going to see on the replay, Seb Brown's windup. There's not a lot of mystery here. He just does a stutter step and he heads right down the sidelines. Lamming making sure that the ball's in front of him. Defender goes a little bit past the ball, not quite, and Seb is able to focus on that ball coming in and bring it in, going out of bounds, basically on the 16-yard line, 17-yard line of the Red Bombers, setting up for first down and 10. Seb Brown lining up on the left-hand side again. Lamming looks to his right. Easy, quick look in pass. Goes down on his knees, so he's ruled down. Number 14, Andrew Sparks, was the receiver.
Lamming's pass complete to number 14, Andrew Sparks. He's got five. It'll be second and five, Seawolves.
So as we can see, in between the 10-yard lines, Lamming's been very successful with the Seawolves' offense, but unfortunately, there's been three times that they've been unsuccessful on these drives to get any points. With one time not able to gain a first down and two times throwing interceptions near or in the Red Bomber end zone. They want to make sure that they pay off on their investment here. They're setting up with second down and five. Lamming looking to his left. Deeper ball for 88 and makes the nice move inside for a touchdown, Seawolves.
Lamming complete to
number 88 to Justin Demons.
And he gets the ball over the goal line. That is a touchdown, Seawolves.
Here comes the replay. Again, you're going to see Lamming as he sets up. And he's going to quickly look to his left-hand side. You see the UNB defenders giving all kinds of room. He was wide open by at least 7 yards. UNB defensive back trying to make up ground, but Demons is a considerable force once he comes near the goal line and is able to be successful with 6 points. Seawolves are setting up for the extra point. Again, not necessarily showing off how many math majors are in the squad. The extra point is wide. So now we have a score of 48 UNB Red Bombers, 20 University of New Brunswick St. John Seawolves, with 6 minutes and 4 seconds left in the game. We'll see if the Seawolves give possession back to the Red Bombers, or they're going to try a short kick, or see if they can retain possession by a little bit of trickery and continue to edge away at that lead that the Red Bombers have. So Justin Demons with one touchdown for the Seawolves, two by Seb Brown. We have Jake McKay and Sam Phillips with two touchdowns each for the Red Bombers. We've got Manderville and Doucette with touchdowns, as well as Jonah Rollins for the Red Bombers. Number 60, Connor Pelkey, set up to get the ball back in play. And mid-level kick. Big return coming from the Red Bombers. And like he did a couple of times in the last game, Gabriel Saint-Germain takes the ball for the Red Bombers, crosses midfield, and will set up for the Red Bombers to scrimmage first down and 10. 5 minutes and 54 seconds left in the game.
First and 10, Red Bombers.
And I don't know if you can see it from our camera angle, but the bomb site still has a considerable amount of UNB alumni and Red Bomber alumni that are partaking of some of the beverages of the afternoon. And there will be, if anybody's in earshot, a gathering of some of the Red Bomber alumni at the Coulter Room after this game today. Motion in both ways ends up coming the ball right back up the middle. For number 28, Connor Stiles was the ball carrier once again for the Red Bombers.
Pretty close to 8 yards, it'll be second and 2 for the Red Bombers.
So all kinds of motion in the backfield for the Red Bombers, but once again it ends up being just a dive play up the middle with that considerable offensive line of the Red Bombers carrying the load for them once again. Collins hands the ball off again, and he keeps it to the left-hand side. Making a big scoot. Ooh, a bit of a horse collar tackle call, I think, by the head referee.
Rollins keeps. And he gets what looks like an up yard for the first down.
And not sure if I can see, but if I have the right call, it is illegal to reach. Oh, we've got a holding call. And an objectionable call against the Seawolves because of that horse collar tackle. So we'll see which penalty takes precedence.
Holding and objectionable conduct, both against the Red Bombers.
No. So, still wondering what's going to... Looks like they're marching this a fair amount back for the Red Bombers. Small discussion between the head referee and head coach Spurgeon, and the head referee takes exception to that. And then... So, it's we're going to see what happens here. So there was pointing towards the Seawolves, but it doesn't look like they've been penalized that much. So let's see what we got. First down and 10 for the Red Bombers.
Against the Seawolves.
So lots going on that didn't seem to transpire very much. And away we go for the Red Bombers, first down and 10. Rollins steps back. Oh! Throws the ball down the middle. Oh, just tipped at the last second by Jordan Betteridge by the Seawolves.
Rollins pass just tipped by Jordan Betteridge.
Or we would have had the Red Bombers again with another 6 points in that Matt LaFleur was wide open. So great play by Rollins to get away from those defenders and get that ball off, but big defensive play by Jordan Betteridge. So now we've got second down and 10 with 5 minutes left in the game. Matt LaFleur into the game. Rollins stepping back at quarterback. Equal split with the receivers. Rollins stepping back, looking downfield. Wide open. Oh, through the hands of number 5, Thomas Hoyt.
Pass intended for Thomas Hoyt.
This will be third down for the Red Bombers.
That'll bring up third down and 10 for the Red Bombers.
As that ball was traveling, it looked like Hoyt would be all set up, but the free safety from the Seawolves was able to at least do a little bit of gaining the attention of Thomas Hoyt, and he wasn't able to find the handle of that pass. So now we've got 4 minutes and 33 seconds left in the game. Appears like the Red Bombers are going to set back to punt the ball back to the Seawolves. Again, too many men on the field for UNB, but they were able to make that switch with Doucette. Ball rolls back to the punter, but he's able to get it off. Seb Brown waiting for the ball to come down, and it rolls out of bounds just in front of the 20-yard line. Good punt by the Red Bombers to set up the Seawolves first down and 10 deep in their own end. So we're now going to see if the Seawolves can walk this way and score and move this up a little bit more for the Seawolves. But a lot of ground to gain, being down 48-20 at this juncture of the game. Time is whistled in by the head referee. I would imagine the Red Bombers defense is going to set back a little bit more, wanting to make sure that they don't give away too many big gains with 4 minutes left in the game. Runners off to the left-hand side. That was number 17, Keegan Duffley, with a nice gain for the Seawolves. And looks like he's able to get a first down. Red Bombers unable to contain Keegan Duffley on that left-hand run, and now setting up for first down and 10. Defensive back giving up lots of ground to the receivers by the Seawolves. Lamming set up, looking to his left-hand side right away. Number 18, Manny Kalubi, not able to find the handle. He was wide open on that play. It's going to be second down.
I like this.
Lamming's pass intended for Manny Kalubi. Incomplete. It'll be second and 10, Seawolves.
Jared Lamming setting up. He's got Seb Brown on his left-hand side. And it's a handoff up the middle. Looks like Keegan Duffley one more time. Short of the first down.
Keegan Duffley with the carry.
Third down and two.
He picks up eight, and it'll be third down and two for the Seawolves. And that is the 3 minute warning.
Head official giving the 3 minute warning, but there's 2 minutes 30 seconds left in the game. Don't see too much energy with the Seawolves, so I think they're going to try their best to put another score up here, but going to have a tough time making up the ground that they've given to them. Got a timeout called by the Seawolves. So with 2 minutes and 19 seconds left in the game, Red Bombers look like they would be successful for one more time. Last two games, it's been really easy to find an outstanding player for the Red Bombers, but take your pick. We've got Jake McKay with two touchdowns, Sam Phillips, two touchdowns. I'm going to throw this to the run of the broadcast booth, and we're going to see who we pick for the outstanding player of the game. I think it's straightforward for the University of New Brunswick St. John Seawolves that Seb Brown was their outstanding player today. So we're set to come back here. We've got the players ready, and here we go. Head referee coming in. And third down and two. Lamming set back, looks to his right, quick look in pass, and once again, number 18, Manny Kalubi's not able to bring it in. That's a failure to gain. And that ball will go back to the Red Bombers. First down and 10 with 2 minutes, 14 seconds left in the game. So it looks like this result is something that we can count on. And if the end of this game, UNB Red Bombers will be 3 wins and no losses and will be in first place. And, of course, waiting to see what happens with the Holland College Hurricanes and Dalhousie Tigers this afternoon. Ball snapped to get us back going, and we're up the middle one more time with Connor Stiles. Looks like Connor Stiles was able to make about 6 yards and should have 4 yards more to go if they're able to gain a first down. Connor Stiles once more up the middle. Nice big hole set up by that offensive line, and it's going to be first down and 10 for the Red Bombers.
Connor Stiles with the carry. Connor picks up a Red Bombers first down.
So less than 2 minutes now in the game. Red Bombers content to let the clock tick as they set up for the next play. No surprise here. Connor Stiles to the left-hand side. And looks like he had lots of room available to him.
He gets half the yardage.
But unfortunately tripped over the 20-yard line, so it'll be second down for the Red Bombers. One minute 30 left in the game. Connor Stiles up the middle.
Stiles up the middle. He's 2 yards short of the first down. It'll be third down for the Red Bombers.
So you get you at home get 3 guesses on what the next play is going to be, and the first don't count. We're anticipating Connor Stiles one more time to try and gain this first down for the Red Bombers. Oh, Rollins is able to pull the ball back from Connor Stiles, and let's see if he was able to make that first down.
Well, Rollins keeps this time. He's close to the first down.
Offside call by the head referee. That is declined by the Red Bombers, and we would imagine it is first down and 10 for the Red Bombers
offside
deep into the Seawolves area.
The Seawolves. The Red Bombers have declined that penalty.
And the yard markers in the down box do move downfield, so now it's first down and 10 for the Red Bombers with less than a minute in the game. And it appears that the Red Bombers are going to take a knee and let as much time on the clock go down, so they'll probably have 2 plays where they'll take a knee, and that should be the end for the game today. And that's the first time.
Rollins takes a knee.
I would imagine they've got to do this one more time, and that would be
one
all she wrote.
And that should take us to the end.
Red Bombers doing their best to let the clock tick down as much as they can. Takes a knee. Head referee indicates that is it. And
Rollins,
that is done at BMO Field.
And that is the game. Final score. The Red Bombers 48, the Seawolves.
So there we have it. It is 48 for the UNB Red Bombers, 20 for the UNB SJ Seawolves. From a very different game from what the Red Bombers have seen in the last couple of weeks, in that they were able to put up a touchdown early. Seawolves came back and were able to tie it up. But from that time on, the Red Bombers had their way with the Seawolves with a couple of touchdowns from Josh McKay, 2 touchdowns from Sam Phillips. Josh Rollins had a touchdown, Manderville, and Doucette as well. And of course, Seb Brown was the scorer for the Seawolves. So thanks again for joining us. We had a great afternoon. That finishes off with the Red Bombers being undefeated, and we look forward to seeing you. Red Bombers are on the road, so we won't be doing some broadcasts for the next couple of weeks, but looking forward to seeing you soon. So that's it from BMO Field. Thanks a lot for joining us, and you take care.